Discussion Podcast. I am your host, Roman Sanzo, and joining me today is Silver-Quill.
I have seen the Great Apple Spirit. It was delicious.
Oh, what do you mean?
I mean that you shouldn't look for it anymore.
Alrighty then. Also joining us today is the Terra.
You're a monster. How could you do that?
Surprisingly easily. You just, you know, put some peanut butter on it and munch away. Nom nom
nom. But you're ruining the little filly's chance of catching it. Where's the fun in that?
Terra, there's something you they can't catch. You better run.
Okay.
If you need to throw like a big old blue ball at it,
yeah,
we can help with that.
Yeah, I'm guessing there's an industry for it now.
Yeah, you always got Silver's great blue balls.
Oh, boys. But anywho, in today's episode, we are going to review Season 9, Episode 10, Going to Seed. In this episode, Applejack's plan for an ordinary harvest goes awry. Awry? That's how you say it? A-W-R-Y?
Awry.
Awry, when Apple Bloom becomes obsessed with catching a magical creature she thinks can help them. And, well, before we pop in to, well, the review, or this episode, first impressions are in order. And Silver, what do you think?
I'm bored by this episode. I'm sorry, it's not that interesting to me. I understand the message is trying to convey, but I worry it's actually conveyed an opposite. In fact, maybe even a harmful one. So we'll get into it as we get a review proper, but this might have been a low point in Season 9. Which is unfortunate because Applejack is my fave. Well, second fave after Fluttershy, but still, she's up there. And I want to have her character treated right.
True. And what about you, Terra?
First impression, I also thought it was kind of boring. I mean, I did want to enjoy this, but didn't really get my attention. I didn't even remember much from this episode.
Oh, yeah. That's bad then. And, well, as for me, not a highlight. Like, this is one of those episodes where it's not good, but it's not bad. It's just meh. And, oh, man, the way that we're going to approach this episode is not true how we normally do this. We're going to go for something different, something we haven't tried in a long time before. But anywho, if you guys have not watched this episode yet, go watch it first, then join us. Welcome back. I hope you enjoyed the episode. And, well, the way we're going to approach this episode is with the lesson itself. The whole leading Apple Bloom on to the myth, the legend of... who now? The legend of the Great Seedling, was it?
Yeah. Let's see here.
I think it was.
The Great Seedling. A magical earth spirit, which they use the term earth.
Yeah. But anywho, we're going to approach this one first because I find this rather disruptive for the farm. And there's a lot of questions that we can bring up about how come didn't they invite the other clans that really need that screen time, like Brayburn or even Caramel? Like Caramel's part of them, right? No?
Is he? I don't remember him. We've got to pull up Apple Family Reunion real quick.
There's a lot of Apple Family members.
Actually, if I remember right, Bon Bon / Sweetie Drops was in there.
Huh, probably dating one of the apples.
Oh, no. Believe me. No.
It was a changeling. It was a changeling.
That would actually be more plausible, but trust me. No spoilers. Yes. I guess that's the long and short of it.
Yeah. Okay, so let's approach this one first. I personally feel that telling Apple Bloom about this story is kind of disruptive to the Apple family's harvest. Like telling her, yo, Apple Bloom, if you catch this mythical creature, all of your harvest woes will go away. Ooh. Wouldn't that be great?
It would. And I agree. I mean, and then Applejack in time gets drawn into it.
That's true, because back in her youth, when she was Apple Bloom's age, she was excited. She was excited, but she had to learn a lesson the hard way about, well, not letting things like this get in the way.
I'm looking at an Apple family picture. Okay. Bon Bon/Sweetie Drops is not in there. Though I could swear I saw her in that episode.
Mm-hmm.
Or that she was somehow involved with the Apple family.
I think she was somewhere there.
But there are a ton of able-bodied ponies, even the oranges, who could come out. Why had they chose the crazy cat lady?
Because Peter knew needed a role, a speaking role.
I am happy that Goldie, her pet cheetah, did not maul her, as previously hinted.
Oh, goodness me.
That's important. Very, very important.
Oh, wait. Hey, turnip seed, yeah.
Hey, seed turnip?
Yeah.
Well, if the comics are right, he's running a multi-million business while feeling dead on the inside because Spike killed his chances with Rarity.
Oh, goodness me.
Although, more realistically, he's probably in Canterlot.
Okay. But anyway, Silver, you want to elaborate on why this telling Apple Bloom this about this story is a bad idea, bad plan, disruptive to the harvest?
Well, it's, how to put it? Imagine if you told a kid if you catch Santa Claus, you'll get twice the presents. That kid is going to put life on hold to create all those traps. And honestly, it's basically, this whole legend is substituting hard work and effort for a quick fix. That is, it stop working on what really needs doing and go chase this legend. And Goldie and Granny Smith, they seem to watch Apple Bloom doing this, putting the others in danger, by the way. And they're like, oh, that's so cute. And I'm kind of with Applejack. We don't have time for this right now. Now's not the time to be chasing a legend. And that's why it's so disappointing when, as they have more strange phenomena, Applejack actually gets caught up in this. I liken it to trying to plan your child's education fund around winning the lottery.
Oh, God, no.
It'd be amazing if it actually happened. But 99.999% says no. This is highly, highly irresponsible. And you need to get back in the game.
I mean, hard work pays off, right?
Yep, true that.
They're advertising the quick fix. And then Applejack gets caught up in it. And it's only thanks to slight abuse of Big Macintosh.
We're not going to touch on we're not going to talk about Big Mac yet, but that guy, he needs his spotlight in our discussion here right now. But the fact of the matter is, right now, it's true what you say, that nothing comes easily. Nothing comes in a flash. Nothing's magical. Or nothing's worth doing is magical, something like that. And with the harvest here right now, how do I put this? The harvesting is, quote-unquote, one of the biggest threat or the biggest conflict right now in the episode. And do you guys think that this is kind of rather tame for a, quote-unquote, conflict?
Well, conceptually, it's interesting, but I think, unfortunately, the confluence of when everything blooms at the same time really doesn't compare to the Zap Apples.
Oh, yeah. Okay, let's just paddle back a bit or go forward. Like, okay, Applejack here says that her friends couldn't really help her because of school. Like, they have their school, whatever it is that they're doing. Right, understandable. But
Whatever they do at that school that we never get to see unless something's going wrong. Oh, I'm a cranky clown today.
Yeah. No, but the thing is, I'm just thinking about this way. Why not invite these students to help? That would have been an amazing development for the student six.
Problem with bringing the students is that you invite a very cynical interpretation. Oh, you need cheap labor? Well, just offer an internship. At which point, I think the school takes another one on the chin.
Oh, yeah.
And it can't afford that anymore.
Yeah. But at the same time, too, I understand what you just said, Silver. Like, it's a valid point. Like, people or the quote-unquote Student 6 haters would really just bash it, or the haters of the school would really bash it. But why not, right? For extra credits or cultural understanding, because it could work.
Actually, now that I think about it, I remember a time, I forget what year, I don't know if I was in elementary school or maybe high school, I don't exactly remember, but I know one time I went on a trip to a farm, and we were literally doing some farm work. We were getting, like, maple syrup, we were going around doing some other work stuff, and, I was young at the time, so, you know, it was all fun for me. It's like, oh, this is fun to do.
Yeah. I mean, see, Totara gets free maple syrup only in Canada.
Yeah.
You got played, son.
Yeah, but
you got played.
Yeah, but he gets free maple syrup fresh from the sap.
Yes.
You are the sap.
No, but I kind of want to see that. Like, the students don't really understand what's going on or trying to understand. And then Yona, like, just jumps and suddenly every apple just falls down. I mean, that could have worked.
Well, I think the goal for this episode is the last hurrah of the apple family. I mean, okay, there's maybe one more, but it has a different focus. Mm-hmm. This is the apple family doing for the apples. Even, and this is probably the highlight of the episode for me, mm-hmm. a return image of Bright Mac and Pear Butter.
Oh, yeah.
Yay! Carried a baby apple bloom.
Yeah. Oh, God. That was awesome. That was like, oh, man.
That scene was very adorable.
Yeah. But
and then their daughter is trapped at the bottom of a pit, and they leave her there.
Oh, boys.
Well, I mean, in her defense, they didn't really know she was down there. And in the flashback, it's not like she's calling out for help or anything.
Yeah, that's the problem there. But anywho.
Still.
Yeah, but still. But anywho, so we talk about the whole myth and mythological, like, it's not good. Like, we can't even defend it if you wanted to, right?
Here's the thing. The point of that flashback, besides getting to see Bright Mac, Pear Butter, Big Mac inherits a yolk, mm-hmm. and all that good stuff, it's supposed to say that Applejack lost her playfulness on that day, that she was so angry at missing the harvest that she's lost something.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Applejack does have a spirit of fun. It's just that right now, this situation really does call for all hooves on deck and to really work at it. And she's not, like, cruel to Apple Bloom. She even gives her permission as long as she sees to the harvest.
Which is...
But I feel like they're getting the message a bit mixed. There's a quote by C.S. Lewis that I often enjoy. In fact, I often invoke whenever someone says, oh, you're an adult watching a kid's cartoon. Critics who treat adult as a term of approval instead of as a mere descriptive term cannot be adults themselves. To be concerned about being grown up, to admire the grown up because it is grown up, to blush at the suspicion of being childish, these things are the marks of childhood and adolescence. And in childhood and adolescence, they are, in moderation, healthy symptoms. Young things ought want to grow. But to carry on into the middle or even into early manhood, this concern about being adult is a mark of really arrested development. When I was 10, I read fairy tales in secret and would have been ashamed if I had been found doing so. Now that I am 50, I read them openly. When I became a man, I put away childish things, including the fear of childishness and the desire to be very grown up.
Well, I can understand that. But at the same time, too, like, this scenario here is, yeah, see, the lesson here is a mixed bag of almost everything. They want to do the story about, okay, you shouldn't be banking all your hopes and dreams on this fable. But at the same time, too, they want to have a bonding moment between Applejack and Apple Bloom. And, oh, God, there's just so much to unpack in this one.
Well, I agree, but here's the thing about that quote. it's not, in this case, it's not Applejack being afraid that she's not being grown up enough. In this case, it's that they're letting the imagination now distract them from responsibility, which is part of being grown up.
Oh, yeah. And part of that responsibility is thrown to Big Mac. And, well, let's talk about the old boy. And poor fella, chart out the apple farm, plan everything, giving responsibility to ponies here and there. And suddenly, the guest character, who now? Goldie Delicious is here. Okay, you need to redo the map. And, oh, goodness me. This is just poor on him. That he's overworked. He's tired. He's overworked. And things are not going well for him.
Well, you kind of have to feel bad for him in this episode.
Yeah, totally.
It's like, Sugar Bill, get over here and give him a kiss. He needs something good to happen to him.
Sugar Bill's not even there. She's working on her own project.
But, like, I mean, now that with Golden Delicious there, he's got to take care of all the cats now, too, because all the cats are going to get in the way while he's harvesting the apples.
Oh, yeah. 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 But still, it's a very hard one to talk about, because most of the job here we see Big Mac doing after Applejack and Apple Bloom kind of discards their responsibility.
Yeah. So, and then we find out, okay, is talk about Big Mac also part of the big reveal?
Yeah, let's go, man.
Basically, that he's been the one harvesting at night. So basically, while they've been slacking off, he's been pulling double duty in his sleep.
Yeah.
I mean, that's got to be a great talent, though, right there. I mean, yes, he's been working too hard. But, I mean, if he's able to do that all in his sleep, then I'm impressed.
Yeah.
Well, but that's the thing. It's his sleep, but it's not restful sleep.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, can you imagine editing videos while sleeping?
Oh, my God. That would be a dream.
I would question what I saw the next morning. What is with all these flash frames? Was I drunk? Don't edit while drunk.
Oh, God, no.
No, you don't want to edit while drunk.
No, you do not want to. Oh, boys. But in all honesty, like, okay, we do rag on this episode a lot. Poor Big Mac, and yeah, he's the, whatchamacallit,
the butt of all jokes in this episode.
That, and also the great seedling spirit of the whatever it is. So, yeah, somehow he's responsible for it. And, God.
Also, is it me, or is this actually one of the crueler things in equestrian myths? I mean, most of them, it's like, oh, you see the spirit, or you are visited by it. No, this one, you have to capture it. You have to deny it its freedom and won't let it go unless it actually does your bidding. What the hey, Equestria?
I mean, it kind of sounds like something I know.
What?
Catching a mythical creature and then make it do your bidding.
I got no idea, Stara. I mean, it's all so familiar.
It's drawing a blank here for me.
Torterra, use irony attack.
Oh, the irony.
Oh, it wasn't very effective.
Damn.
But I don't know. Like, I don't know. I mean, it's one of those things where usually when they mention something mythical in the show, it kind of exists.
Usually.
Oh, are we at the point where we can talk about our opinion on the episode again?
Yeah, sure. Go ahead, man.
Okay. So, like I said, this is boring, but in all honesty, I kind of was expecting something else. Like, I kind of thought, like you said, you know, mythical creatures are usually real. And I thought what was going to happen is that they actually finally captured the great seedling. But then the great seedling's like, hey, you know, I do all this stuff, but I need to go to other places too to help them out with their crops. And then they realize, oh, okay, maybe what we're doing is wrong and we shouldn't capture him and make him do our bidding. So, you know, the great seedling helps him out, and then the great seedling takes off and leaves a trail, and then they be like, oh, well, I'm pretty sure we'll see him again, and an episode ends. But no, that it just turns out that it was just Big Mac, and then you see a trail of carrots, and I'm like, really? I mean, I was expecting something more out of this.
I can agree with you, but my take is a bit different. At the end, it's revealed that Big Mac is the one that's doing it and whatnot. Like, we have a laugh. And then Applejack and Apple Bloom sees the carrots, and then, oh, they go off on an adventure. And remember in season 4 when they talk about the shadow pony?
Yes. I think that was season 4.
Yeah, with the eyes glowing. I was hoping for that.
Yeah, they did that a lot in season 4. Even the one with Flutterbad and how they show the teeth growing at the end, yeah, but yeah. Never brings up again.
Yeah, I want that. Like, give us that. So it's like, oh, wait, was it real? Was it not? Ooh, surprising.
I mean, even the lesson, I mean, I don't even know if it is kind of a lesson. I mean, what I got from the episode is that, I mean, even though you're an adult or you're grown up, it doesn't hurt to feel young like a kid again.
Probably.
I mean, I think that's what I'm getting at least, because I know one time I was with my cousin at his house, and he's older than me, like he's married and everything, but we literally pulled out Nerf guns and we started shooting each other, and we basically felt like kids.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and there's nothing wrong with that. No. Because he wasn't neglecting his children to do so.
Did he have children? Doesn't mean anything.
He does not, though, actually.
Oh, sorry. For some reason, I thought you said he was married. For some reason, I tacked on with kids.
No, not yet, at least. I mean, I'm pretty sure his parents are hoping so.
But that's the thing. I mean, I get what the episode is trying for, but they don't... But it comes at the expense of responsibility, and that's where the message, I think, dies.
Because, like, yes, it doesn't hurt to be a kid again, but you've got responsibilities to do also, so you can't exactly take away, like, you know, all this other stuff just to feel like a kid again.
Yeah, and that's the balance that they didn't really, well, balance out.
I'm a big fan of when a show doesn't do something well, it's really good to provide an alternate example, you know, something to make you believe. So, if you don't mind, I'll bring one other show into this real quick.
All right.
It's called Tokusatsu Ga Ga Ga. It is the story of a woman in Japan who enjoys what is basically Power Rangers here in America.
Okay.
Except better.
Okay.
Except better. Like, way better. So she and friends want to go have a sort of a play day at the beach, but they get rained out. The weather's not great. And one friend who's still in college is like, oh, let's just spend the night and we can try again tomorrow. The other's like, oh, no, sorry. I have to be back at work. I've got to, you know, clean up the house. And the college friend becomes depressed because it's like you're becoming an adult. You don't have as much time to do things flippantly. But what I really like about this episode is they say, you don't stop having fun just because you grow up. You just have to plan a little in advance, you know, budget. And they find a way to still have fun even if the weather is not cooperative. In fact, it's so not cooperative that it actually looks quite pleasant out, but they have to act like it isn't.
No.
And even text appears on the screen saying, yeah, the weather really didn't want to work with us during filming.
Wow. Wow.
So that's, in my eyes, that episode did this way better than My Little Pony. And maybe that's not a fair comparison, but it still means something.
True. But, like, I think the biggest problem with this episode is the balancing act of what do we really want out of this episode.
Well, I stated what I was hoping out of this episode.
Yeah. But I think, like, it really wanted to do the bonding between Apple Bloom and Applejack. But they had to do a narrative where it kind of leads them to that. And said narrative was the great seedling creature. But because of that, I think they created this one scenario where Every solo Applejack episode has to be quote-unquote bad. It feels that way.
Well, for one very simple reason. Applejack is the even keel of the group. She's usually there to help them get centered when they lark off. It doesn't work when you send Applejack into crazy land.
Yeah.
Applejack's at her best when you surround her with chaos and absurdity, and you see her trying to navigate it. It was like that with the Kirin in Sounds of Silence.
Oh, yeah.
That's true.
True, true. At least that one was a lot of fun and stable, because Applejack was trying to understand what was going on. But here, she clearly understands what is going on, and she knows the risk of it.
So, yeah, it's a hard episode because this is the last Applejack episode?
I think it is the last Applejack episode.
Let me double check. Let me double check, because I feel like there's more to it.
Let's
see. Between the Dark and Dawn? Oh, that one is the last one.
Yeah, that's the...
Twofold, okay. A Trivial Problem, okay. The Sun... The Summer Suns, okay. Yeah, that was the last one.
Yeah, that's the last Applejack episode.
Oh, no. All right.
No me gusta.
All right. So, anyhow, let's wrap it up. Let's wrap it up.
Yeah.
Let's go to final thoughts. Silva.
It's not just the case that this isn't the most interesting episode. I mean, there have been some that just feel a little paint by numbers at times. No, this is bad. This is a bad episode in my eyes because the message and its presentation actually seem harmful. It actually encouraging bad behavior in the audience. And because it's the last Applejack-ish episode, that really, really frustrates me. She deserves better than this because she's a great character.
True that. Yeah. Poor her. This is... yeah, she deserves more than this, but hey, what can we say, right?
You can say,
That's all you can say at this point.
True that. Anyway, Tara, what about you?
Pretty much like I said earlier, I was expecting more out of this and was kind of expecting the story to go a bit differently, but instead we got this where it turns out it was not true and yeah, like it's that boring. It never really caught my attention.
Yeah, and as for me, this episode was, meh, it's not memorable, it's not, I wouldn't say fun, it's not memorable. There were a lot of scenes here that I could say, like, there was a lot of fun. It's fun to see where Big Mac was bucking a tree and showing off to Applejack. Like, yeah, look at that, I can do this strong. And Applejack was doing a tornado kick, like, yeah, beat that.
Spinning apple kick.
Yeah, but still, it's a few scenes like that ain't going to quote unquote fix the episode. And overall, it was okay. The ending for this one, though, I was rather miff because the carrots are in a shape or in a pattern or something like that. So does this mean the what's that creature called?
The Great Seedling.
The Great Seedling.
The Great Seedling. Was it real?
Jinx.
Yeah. So was it real? Was it not? And let's go find out. Oh. So yeah, that ending there was just like, okay, I see what you're trying to do. Okay. But anywho, well, that's done. That's our opinion. I hope you like the style change. Do let us know in the comments below. But anywho, Silver, what are we going to do next week?
Well, we're not quite done with the apples yet, are we?
Oh, yeah.
We are going to go forth to the IDW Comics in issue number 70, in which case the Golden Horseshoe Gals get a game of extreme bingo.
Okay, no.
Extreme!
Oh, wow. This is going to be really extreme. Oh, man. I could just imagine. Bungee jumping and calling out numbers. B50! Oh, no! Yeah. So, anywho, that will be next week's thing. And, well, it'll be a fun one. Yes. So, anyway, if you have any questions, concerns, or suggestions for the show, you can contact us at thembsregime.com. You can also reach us on the Twitters. The show's Twitter account is at MBS Show, and my personal Twitter account is at Norman Sanzo. And Silver, where can the good people find you?
Well, you can find me on the YouTubes just through a search for Silver Quill or After the Fact. You can also find me on Twitter and DeviantArt under MLP Silver Quill. And you can find me posting on Equestria Daily every Wednesday with either an editorial or a comic review. And you can find me on the Patreons under MLP-Silver-Quill. Plus, if you happen to be going to Ponyville Cider Fest this year, you'll see me there. Hello!
Awesome, awesome, awesome. So, don't forget, if you go to... Where was it again? Ponyville Cider Fest?
Ponyville Cider, yeah.
Yeah.
In Milwaukee.
Yep. If you go there, do say hi to Silver. He's going to enjoy the little conversation while he tries to go to the bathroom. Yes, I'm still on that.
Yes.
So anyway, Tara, where can the good people find you?
Well, the good people could find me on Facebook, Devin, or at Twitter, or YouTube under the name Tortoise1324, or they could just simply do a Google search, and I'm pretty sure I'll be on all of those. And they could also donate to me on my Patreon page as well, under the name Tortoise1324.
Awesome, awesome, awesome. Go do so, go do so. So you're not going to any cons?
No, for now I'm just taking it easy because, like I said, I was busy with my brother Stag and Doe, and I actually have my cousin's wedding coming up next, not next week, actually, this Saturday coming up.
Wow, wait, this Saturday, wow, Weebly won't be typing on me stuff, I'm not going to talk about it. So yeah, hope you have a great time, man. Hope you have a great time.
Yeah, maybe sometime in the future I'll be attending a lot of cons. Who knows? Maybe one day, hoping, I'll be a community guest like Silver.
Yay. I'm
there we go.
I'm hoping for that every day of my life. But anyway.
Yeah, I still think that one idea should happen where we have an MBS show panel.
Yeah, but the problem is that the panelist application needs to be there and stuff. You know what? It's all wobbly. It's just confusing. Yeah. Anyway, and also please subscribe to us on iTunes, YouTube. Don't forget to press the bell icon to stay up to date. And Stitcher Radio, and also like our Facebook page. You can also catch us on PonyvilleLive.com. Links are in the show notes. If you'd like to support the show, you can do so at patreon.com/MBSshow. With every support, you get a week's early access to review and discussion podcasts, exclusive and deleted content. And a huge thank you from me. Talking about the thank yous, I would like to thank Amy, Lucky Knight, Master Flag, Tristan, and also Jeffrey. Thank you so much, guys. You are great. So anyway, I have been Norman Sanzo.
I am the Silver Quill.
And I am Torterra.
And we'll guys catch you next week with another fun episode of the MBS show. See ya.
Adios.
Bye-bye. All right, Norman, let's go catch the great hippogriff.
Wait.
Aha, I am beyond you.
Okay, do we need to carry a shotgun or something like that? Because,
yes, because he's going to fly away and we need to take him down, then we're going to eat some chicken.
We like the chickens.
I call the leg.